team in baseball. The one team's pain is another team's opportunity, and the Indians plan on adding to their 1-0 lead. Hi, everyone. Welcome inside the Fox Network Center. Jeannie Zelasco along with Kevin Kennedy. The road to the World Series goes through Fox Sports, your exclusive home for the entire postseason. Of course, Game 1 between the Mariners and the Indians was summed up best by the Seattle Times. Instead of arguing over diamond earrings, the only gem was Bartolo Colon. 8 shutout innings, Kevin.
Well, we said a couple of days ago, Jeannie, this guy should be dominant, and he was in a big game in daylight. Some shadows out there. Didn't matter. This guy was throwing 98 to 99 miles an hour all game long. 10 strikeouts, command of the fastball, command of the curveball. Bartolo Colon should be the ace of the staff, like Pedro Martinez is to Boston. Some good fastball right there to Boone. He blows Olerud away. And then look in the eighth inning right here. First pitch to McLemore. Good morning, 97 miles an hour. Good afternoon, 98 miles an hour. And good night. 99 miles an hour in the eighth inning right there. This guy was absolutely outstanding. 2 walks, 10 Ks. The key was he had command. He didn't walk many men. This guy came up big in game one for the Cleveland Indians.
All right, on to another ace who did not hit his mark. One small twinge for Rogers, one great pain for the Yankees. Clemens not only suffered the game one loss, he struggled through 4 innings last night and eventually left in the 5th with a tight right hamstring. The Yankees ace said he felt a familiar pain when he picked up Johnny Damon's bouncer leading off the 4th. Who knows whether he'll be good to go for a game 5 start? Worse yet for New York, who knows if there will be a game 5.
Tear or something, you know, extremely bad in it, and they're going to let me go out there. I'm going to go out there to pitch and try and beat somebody. So I don't really worry about injuries or soreness or swelling at this time of year. Just do what you can.
First things to go for an aging power pitcher, 39 years old, like a Roger Clemens, are your legs. A little twinge here and there, that's what's affected him the last couple of years. That's why he stays in such great shape. Now, if there is a game 5, and I believe there will be, Clemens says, I'm going to pitch, I'll make some adjustments. He won't be able to use the power in his legs. He'll have to use his upper body more. He won't have the same fastball, but he's still got the good split, the good curveball. He'll become more of a finesse pitcher, believe it or not, but I think he will pitch.
All right, so what was more painful for George Steinbrenner to watch, Roger Clemens or the umpires? You make the call. Steinbrenner says it's tough to compete against a team as good as the A's with the umps being less than good.
Well, you know, the Yankees have had their share of breaks over the year. Remember 1996 against Baltimore, the home run ball, Jeffrey Maricott, that should have been fan interference. 1998, Mark Langston had Tino Martinez struck out. Next pitch goes for a home run. Well, last night it went the other way. A little ground ball right here by David Justice in the middle of the ball game to flip the first base. Now, running down the line here, you got to stay in between the 2 white lines the last 45 feet. Dana DeMuth says, no, he did not.
He was on the bag! He was on the bag already! Hey, I know, he was on the bag already! He was on the bag, Dana!
Now, Lee Mazzilli is making a good point, saying he was already on the bag. He beat the play. The throw was way too late. According to the rule book, 605K, 709K says it doesn't matter. It's the umpire's discretion. If the runner runs outside of those 2 white lines the last 45 feet, he can call him out no matter what. This time the breaks did not go the Yankees' way.
Yeah, bottom line, what comes around goes around. Unless, sometimes, of course, you are the Houston Astros, because they're stuck on the same page. The Major League Baseball postseason has just one home. Watch the tourney unfold only on Fox.
You're right. They're stuck on the same page. Atlanta looks pretty good now, going back home up 2-0. St. Louis is big evening this series, beating Randy Johnson yesterday. Oakland needs to win game 2 because Pettitte usually comes up big in game 2. And the Cleveland Indians come up huge in game 1. By winning and beating a Seattle Mariner ball club that's not used to losing any type of series this year. We'll find out today, because they got to win game 2. It's almost a must-win situation for the Seattle Mariners.
This, of course, a travel day for the National League, and Bobby Cox not with his team in Atlanta. His sister took very ill. He is with her, so it's still up in the air as to whether or not he will be on the bench for game 3 on Friday. Still ahead, pressure, but pressure. As we look live at the Emerald City, the Mariners haven't felt the heat since April. This isn't a must win, but it is a real test. And with the smell of cologne still lingering in the Seattle air, the Indians break out their real secret weapon. Chuck Finley, Kevin explains when we come back. Shadows moving in at Safeco Field. A 15-year absence, Chuck Finley has never been more ready to pitch in October. Jamie Moyer has never been more hungry for a postseason win. Of course, playing in the second season should be cherished and enjoyed, according to Finley. You never know when it might come again. The Mariners hope they won't start looking at their journey the very same way.
Life goes on, and I don't want to make it sound like, you know, I don't care. I do care. I care dearly. We've come too far to just throw it away. But I do know that we're going to go out and we're going to play well and play hard. And at the end of 9 innings or 10 innings or 12 innings, whatever it is, hopefully that we're the winners.
I feel like I'm at top form to go out there. I mean, if my arm was about to fall off, I would still go out there. If it was showing signs of tendons breaking and blood vessels hanging out, I'd still go out there tomorrow and try to throw. That's how bad I want to be out there.
Now, a real interesting thing about these two guys, aside from the numbers, look at the age combined, 76 years old. That's a major league record for two guys starting a playoff game. And different pitchers completely, contrasting. Moyer's a changeup, backdoor curveball guy that throws a fastball at tops about 85, 86 miles an hour. This is what he's going to do right here for the Cleveland Indians. Backdoor curveball, then he gets you looking for his changeup, and he'll throw an 85 fastball. Looks like 95. Finley, on the other hand, is more power. Power slider, power curve, power fastball. He gets the lefties out right there with sliders. He's got a good forkball and a good sinking fastball. That's going to help because the Cleveland Indians are so strong around the infield with their defense. And Chuck Finley, remember, has not pitched in a playoff game since 1986 when he was a rookie with the old California Angels, and he was in the bullpen then. So this is his first postseason start.
You know, we all look at Chuck Finley as a Yankee killer, but actually his lowest ERA comes against Seattle, which doesn't bode well for this Mariners team. They've gone 22 consecutive postseason innings versus Cleveland without scoring a run.
Well, you know what? The Seattle Mariners have been shut down. The Indians play good defense, and they shut down Ichiro, first of all. And that's what we talked about the other day. Now, here's Brett Boone. You got to stop him. That's one of the guys we talked about. They did that. Other key we talked about was Ichiro. Even though he got on base, they threw over to first base. They messed up his timing. They pitched out at the right time. They stopped him from scoring. So they had two keys. They shut down Boone and Ichiro. And defensively, they did their thing. Tome on the right side with a 3-6-3 double play. Anytime you get a ground ball and you can get it to the middle guys, Omar Vizquel or Robbie Alomar, you are in good, good shape. Now, Cleveland Indians 8-2 in game two of playoff series since 1995. Remember, that was a 95 team that won 100 ball games during that season and did not end up winning the World Series. Cleveland has shut out Seattle for 22 straight postseason innings. As you mentioned, Jeannie, Seattle, Ichiro, even though the batting average was up and it was helped in game one, he did not score, and that's the key. Don't let him score. Seattle, Moyer has had success this year against the Cleveland Indians, 2-0, 0.64 earned run average, but not historically. This is the best year he's pitched against them. Now, teams with a better regular season record win only 52% of the time, so it's immaterial that Seattle Mariners had 116 wins this year. They're down 0-1 right now. One division series played by teams with the same regular season records. This is a great, great matchup. They've gone back in history before. Seattle Mariners are expected to go to the World Series this year. If they don't win game two, they are in serious trouble because they have not seen Sabathia, and he throws game three, the big lefty.
All that being said, Lou Piniella says there is no sense of urgency, and I'll put you on the manager's hot seat here. What would you have said to your team after game one? Lou Piniella said nothing.
Well, they've lost the first game of series many, many times during a season and come back and won the next two games. That's what they expect to do. They expect to win three games, and it's whether it's three out of four, that's what it has to be right now. They expect to do that. Now, if they don't do that today, you're going to see some panic, a little bit of panic. Not by Piniella. That's why you like an experienced manager in the playoffs. But notice, he did put Jay Buhner in the lineup today because he's hit five home runs in his career against Chuck Finley. So a little tinkering right there with that lineup.
Some true confessions from John Rocker, who admitted to his manager, Charlie Manuel, that he was being harassed. You can't even stand to hear this.
I can't.
He was being harassed by fans in the bullpen, and he threw a cup of water on them in game one.
Unacceptable. You know, this guy is unacceptable. That's why he's not closing right now. Wickman took the job away from him. They handed it to Rocker. He couldn't do it. Forget about it. It's going to be starting pitching, getting to Wickman. Rocker will not be a factor in this series.
Extra security near the bullpen for game two, and keep the bottled water away from the guy. That's going to do it for us. We have a great day of baseball on tap leading up to tonight's showdown on the Fox Network. Game two of the Yankees and the A's. And, of course, your pitching matchup. It is Andy Pettit. He's been in this situation before. Down a game and pitching game two in this series. Tim Hudson, best record as a starter since he became a starter with at least 50 starts. It'll be a good one. But first, the journey continues in Seattle, where the Hunted have become the Hunters. Sure, the Mariners won more regular season games than any team in 25 years, but now they're chasing the Indians for a series split. The road to the World Series continues next on the Fox Networks.
where the Mariners need Jamie Moyer to indeed be larger than life. Cleveland took game one, and today on a very crisp autumn afternoon, game two of the best of five ALDS. And who says that gladiators don't make friends? The game one starters, Garcia and Colon. Bartolo Colon was tremendous. He struck out 10, and Cleveland is up one game to none on the heavily favored Seattle Mariners. Josh Lewin along with Rex Hudler, very nice to have you with us. Yeah, the Mariners won 116 games during the regular season. That doesn't mean anything right now. A very meaningful game for them this afternoon.
That's right, Josh. Their backs are against the wall for the first time, really, all season long. And they know they're not worried about it because during the season they had 15 series that they lost the first game in. And out of those series, four series they lost. So it is no panic. They're not worried about it.
Well, and Jamie Moyer, a guy who's always so cool, so calm, so collected. He's a 20-game winner. He is handed the ball today, and indeed, he says we're down one, no problem.
I don't sense any panic. We're here to play. We're professionals, and so is Cleveland. You know, they're here to play, too. And, you know, they're going to play hard. We're going to play hard. And, in a five-game series, anything can happen.
Jamie Moyer has his game face plastered on. As you can see, all the Mariners seem to. Cleveland countering with Chuck Finley, who acknowledges the original goal for Cleveland was to split here. Now he says, heck with that, let's go home up 2-0.
Well, I think at this point in time, when you get up with a team like Seattle that has such a great season, you get off to a great start like we did with Bartolo and go up a game, you got to put the pedal down and go for the throat. I mean, obviously, if Seattle was up on us, they wouldn't have the same idea about trying to really bury these guys and don't let them come up for air.
What a great matchup today. Finley and Moyer, two 38-year-old left-handed warriors going out there today.
They are, Josh. They're gamers, to use a position player's term. These guys have the respect of their teammates, and that's why Moyer, heck, he runs 5 miles in the offseason a day. That's why Chuck Finley left the Anaheim Angels so he could be a part of the playoffs right here today.
As they pitch today, the roof is open. The forecast for rain is left as we've actually got sunshine. What does all that mean?
Well, that means that, again, it will be tough for the offensive players to see that ball. The shadows are tough. The backdrop's got a little glare on it. But hey, it's big league baseball, and go ahead and play the game.
Both these teams with dynamos atop the batting order, too. They'll be looking to run. Certainly Ichiro is ready to go. The Mariners down one. They load it up for the Central Division champion Cleveland Indians. The first pitch next on Fox Family.
Divisional playoffs
for Fox. All summer long into the fall, they have talked about their team and their mojo, Rex Hudler. They actually won 116 games of 162 to the Seattle Mariners during the regular season. Now they've got to win 3 out of 4. Otherwise, it's Cleveland advancing to play the winner of the Yankees in Oakland.
That should be a great matchup. Today's two left-handed starters are two totally different guys, even though they have the same age, 38 years old. One's a power pitcher in Finley, the other's a soft tosser and a finesse pitcher in Jamie Moyer.
Jamie Moyer will be floating those puffballs up there to a very impressive Cleveland Indian team. Lineup submitted by Charlie Manuel. Let's check it out. In the top of the order, the guys that like to run, they can drop it down too. Lawton and Vizquel set up Alomar Gonzalez. And check it out, Burks and Tommy flip-flop today. Burks 3 for 4 yesterday, right-handed against the lefty Moyer. So Tommy down a notch in the batting order. Fryman, Cordova, and Diaz. And we note that the bottom of the Cleveland order yesterday was outstanding. Jamie Moyer, the oldest first-time 20-game winner in Major League history, gets the call this afternoon.
Yes, and Moyer, you can see he's got the innings pitched over 200, but 20 wins, you're doing something when you're winning 20 games in today's game. He's a crafty guy. Heck, you got to be alive for him. You must not look for that fastball too often because he's not going to throw it. He's a soft tosser, but he's got to keep the ball down and out of the middle of the plate. He's a great at keeping hitters off balance. That's his key if he's going to win today. A lot of ground balls to the infielders.
Mark McGwire has joked that during batting practice to get ready for Moyer, he has asked for Nerf baseballs to go ahead and swing again. Jamie Moyer will be hard-pressed to break 85 miles an hour today. And that's a stark contrast to Freddy Garcia, who was up around 95 in game one. Moyer pretty much turned in this line twice against the Indians. 14 innings this year, and only one earned run allowed. Behind him, he knows that the Mariners have made a dozen fewer errors than any other team in the American League. He is very confident to let the Indians go ahead and put bat to ball. Mark McLemore in for the ailing Carlos Guillen at short, and actually was outstanding. Made a terrific over-the-shoulder catch in the second inning yesterday.
McLemore's been an all-star for Lou Piniella all year. This year, playing different positions. Heck, he's like a wild card in a poker hand. You can put him anywhere. And that's what you want. Somebody you could use. And Jay Buhner's back in there. And he's been a hero for the Mariners for a long, long time. He hits left-handers pretty well. And Lou Piniella has him in there for a big boost.
Jay Buhner used to play right field for the Mariners. That's Ichiro's domain now. So he has pinballed over to left and has to deal with the glare of that sun today. As will Marty Cordova, the Cleveland left fielder.
So Jamie Moyer's got a fastball four-seamer and a two-seamer.
Lawson slaps the first one foul. We are underway.
And that ball sinks and runs. He'll cut the fastball. He's got a curveball, slider, and a changeup. He'll throw changeup off of a changeup. He's got many different pitches and different speeds. And what he'll do is he will read the batter's tendencies. He'll see what he looks like the first couple times around, and then the next time he'll try to pull the string on him even more.
And keep in mind, Jamie Moyer missed out on the Mariners' 9 playoff games last year. He was pitching in a simulated game right before the ALCS. He fractured his left kneecap. On the ground, second base, one out. Lawton and Vizquel yesterday combined to go 1-for-9. So far, Lawton kept off the bases, Vizquel coming up. And Ted Barrett is your home plate umpire today. Rex, is it fair to say that Jamie Moyer would really appreciate a wide outside corner?
Absolutely. But, you know, even though the Indian hitters don't, Moyer always can use a help on an inch or so on the outside black. Right there. Now that was a good strike. And that's what Moyer does. He'll go ahead and go after that, show his fastball, and then he'll try to keep the hitter off balance with nice curve and changeups. And the shadow will be a factor.
Outside corner again. And if you watch the Atlanta-Houston series here on Fox Family, they talked about that outside corner a lot for Tom Glavine. Go there again. He dips it down too low.
Well, Moyer's is very similar in pitching styles. He gets hitters out away. So if you're a right-handed batter, it's not too bad to move up in close to the home plate to take away that left inch on the outside corner.
That is part of the Cleveland game plan. I know, Rex, you talked to Clarence Jones, the hitting coach for the Indians, and he said, absolutely, let's go ahead and scooch up.
Scoot up and even towards the pitcher a little bit just to kind of cut that ball away out of there and challenge him to come in.
Swatted up into the air. And there's McLemore. You know, Hub, the Indians have an advanced scout by the name of Dom Chidi. His dad, Harry, played briefly in the major leagues and had a saying that went something like this. He said, keep those nits and gnats off the bases, because the lions and tigers will kill you. I don't know who's the nit and who's the gnat, Lofton and Vizquel, but that's precisely what the Mariners knew they'd have to do. And they've done it so far here in the first inning.
Well, Charlie Manuel has three guys at the top of his orders that can really maneuver that bat around. They can bunt, hit and run, and these are the players he'll use for small ball. That's what they call it. Hitting and running, running and hitting.
Drifting, third base side, and it's back and out of play. This is the opening of the cage officially. If you're talking Lions and Tigers, Alomar, Gonzalez, Burks, and Tomey. Juan Gonzalez on deck was second this year in runs batted in, had 140. Tag right back to Moyer. Three down. Ichiro and the Mariners coming up. Out pop-out lineout, and Cleveland going down pretty easily in the top of the first against Lou Piniella's Seattle Mariners. Ichiro leads it off. Who else, possibly, would you pick for this assignment? 3-for-4 yesterday. 56 steals during the regular season. Cameron and Boone follow. We'll talk more about Cameron moving up to number two in the order in just a moment. But then Martinez, Olerud, Yap, Buehner, not Javier in left, Wilson, Bell, and McLemore. And a big left-hander, Chuck Finley. Down in the zone, 1-0. Chuck Finley was held this year to only 22 starts. He had back and neck and rib cage injuries. Says he feels great now, though.
That's the big key. Finley says he feels great, and it is Finn to win for the Tribe. He's got to throw strikes. That's the key for most every pitcher. Keep the ball out of the middle. Use the fastball to get to the split finger, and he's tough on righties. Finn, he'll reach around 92 with that fastball. He's not in the mid-90s. I wouldn't say he's not overpowering, but he is a power pitcher. Split finger is his out pitch.
Missing the outside corner.
We'll show you his grips. It's a two-seamer here. He'll sink that one. The four-seam, he keeps it straight. The curve ball has got a little knuckle curve. You see the knuckle there. Then the split finger or fork ball, however you want to call it.
He missed with that splitter. Ichiro is on.
Really, there's a difference between the splitter and the fork ball.
We'll chronicle that in a moment or two. Let's first check the defense for Cleveland. Omar Vizquel. If you're an Indians fan, you have to be rooting for the ball to be hit to him. Vizquel and Alomar, 17 gold gloves combined. And now Cameron coming to the plate for Seattle. Interesting that Lou Piniella would put Cameron, who is 1-for-17 lifetime, at number two in the order behind Ichiro today.
Well, he's the only guy that really matches up with Stan Javier. Usually we're hitting there in McLemore, but Javier's on the bench. It's a switch hitter. It gives Piniella a little extra flexibility with a switch hitter.
The other thing with Cameron hitting second, he is guaranteed to see some fastballs. Once Ichiro is on, the fastball he can hit, it's that splitter that you mentioned, Rex, that has really eaten him up. Twisting this one towards the crowd.
Well, Finley, doesn't have an exceptional pickoff move. What probably is his best move is that the fact he holds the ball. And they'll keep the runner Ichiro in his tracks there. But he's 1.2 to 1.3 seconds from when he breaks his hands and gets the ball to the catcher's glove. And anything over 1.3 should be no problem for Ichiro.
Lou Piniella told us Bartolo Colon was 1.1 to the plate yesterday, and that's why Ichiro was pretty much stapled to the bag all afternoon. That fastball, and it's quickly 0-2.
I'd look to see Ichiro to run early in the count, give the batter a little better chance, but here Cameron's already down 0-2.
Ichiro, remember, was nabbed on a pitch out in game one. Lou Piniella was asked if that was just a lucky guess by Charlie Manuel. He kind of smiled and said maybe, but we changed our signs anyway for today. Pitch to left. Well struck. There it goes.
Regular season home run, sees a mistake by Finley out over the dish, quick hands, pulls his hands through, looked like a fastball up, it just missed. Cameron capitalized.
And again, to recap the game plan, Ichiro gets on, Cameron sees fastball, and it's 2-0 Seattle.
That is an advantage. because the pitcher does not want to throw anything off speed. It gives the runner more time to steal the base.
1-1 pitch to Boone floats away. Something that Indians fans sure don't want to see. Here's the stat we're putting on the screen for you right now.
Pretty impressive.
Up and away, and again, keep in mind, Chuck Finley has waited 15 years pretty much to the date for this opportunity. That's why he signed with Cleveland, figuring they would be in the postseason. Finley hasn't been there since 1986. And he's not doing well. Last postseason Finley was in, one of the most incredible postseason series ever played, the 86 ALCS. He struck out Jim Rice in game six. The Red Sox would go on to win that one anyway. Finley was actually the man that came on in relief of Donnie Moore. After Donnie Moore's home run that he allowed to Dave Henderson. Dave Henderson is in the ballpark today, of all things. He's now a Mariners broadcaster. And here's what we're talking about. Finley watched it fly from the bullpen. Says he remembers the Angels being ready to pour on the field and celebrate. They were one out away from going to the World Series. It didn't happen. Finley suggesting to us yesterday, at the time, he figured, no sweat. We'll come back next year and do this again. There have been 15 next years in the interim.
Finn's got to stop the bleeding quickly here.
Martinez strokes it deep in the center. It is gone!
Missing the mistakes. Here's another one. Finley's catching way too much in the middle of the plate. Edgar inside out, goes dead central, back screen home run. Finn's just having a hard time figuring out why he can't find the corners and keep it out of that zone.
Walk in a home run, single in a home run, and the 15-year wait has provided only this so far this afternoon.
And these Mariners are coming out today being very aggressive. And that has been their style all year long. The backs are against the wall, first time all year as well.
Olerud spooning that one into foul ground. Freiman collected for the first out finally here in the bottom of the first. Two veteran pitchers born within 8 days of each other, Moyer and Finley, each of them left-handed. Each of them Hud married to a minor celebrity, Moyer to the daughter of basketball commentator Digger Phelps, Finley to actress Tawny Katayan. Certainly neither of them expected 4-0 in the first inning today. Jay Buhner got a nice ovation as he stepped in. But you mentioned that Lou Piniella had a choice to make. Go with Javier, a career 323 batter against Finley, or go with the veteran Jay Buhner.
Well, they want to give Buhner a chance to get into postseason play here in game two and face Chuck Finley, the left-hander, who he's faced 69 times. Got 17 hits and 5 home runs in his career off Finley. So he was hoping Jay could connect with one.
I think that's exactly what Lou Piniella is hoping for. Just one big swing today, and that'll justify putting him in there over Javier.
Javier, he's hit 323 off Finley lifetime. Well, that was a big decision for him, but he explained by saying, in fact, Javier's not in there, gives me a switch hitter off the bench, some flexibility.
The plate 3-2.
Finley will work that slow curve and tries to keep the fastball down with a little sinking action. Been way too much of the plate here in the first.
Buter swinging at a bad ball. Diaz has to throw him out. Two down.
That's the split finger that Finley's known for. It's his strikeout pitch. Whenever he gets a hitter down in the count, he's going to go to it, and he trusts Aynar Diaz. That's what's so important about having a catcher like Diaz. You're not afraid to throw that split finger in the dirt. I talked to you earlier about there is a difference between a split finger and a forkball. A forkball, the hitter sees more of a tumbling action out of the pitcher's hand. A split finger, you don't see as much rotation, but the ball has a similar dip towards the plate. Finley uses both at times, one for a strike and one for his out pitch.
Wilson steps in and takes on the inside corner off speed.
Okay, there it is now. It's a little wider grip. You can see the fingers out here. Now the split finger, you're more right up on top of the seams, the split. And that's the effect of the rotation of the baseball.
Splitter has certainly been the out pitch. Or forkball, whatever you want to call it.
Right, there it is in the glove. You can see it. Both fingers are split on top of the ball. As that downward rotation, very difficult for the hitter to pick up.
See if he goes back there on 0-2. He does, but he bounced it.
But that is the effect. You really want to bounce those pitches instead of throwing them for strikes, and that's your out pitch.
Last year, the Indians figured adding Finley was the missing piece to their playoff puzzle. Veteran lefty with a history of shutting down the Mariners and the Yankees. He does shut down Wilson, but the Mariners have been heard from here in the first inning. Home runs by Cameron, and then Martinez. 4-0 Seattle. The storylines we were tracking here in Seattle, the Mariners having gone 22 innings in a row in the postseason against the Indians without scoring a single run. We are reaching for the whiteout currently as Chuck Finley gave up 4 in the first on a pair of two-run home runs. And the Indians with some early work to do. Juan Gonzalez. And what a classic brains versus brawn matchup here. Jamie Moyer, who gets by with guile at 5'11", 160 pounds against the very strapping power hitter Gonzalez.
Gonzalez is 9-for-36 with 2 home runs in his career against Jamie Moyer, 250 average. But Moyer now with a 4-run lead, you'll see him go out and just go right after some of these hitters. Now he's not going to say here it is down the middle of the plate. He's still going to stay on his game, and that is to keep the ball on the outside part. Clarence Jones, the hitting coach, said his guys will be moving up on the plate.
Well, that's classic Moyer right there. Get a big guy to stretch out for one. Rafael Palmeiro, who was teammates with Jamie Moyer in both Chicago and Baltimore, has referred to Jamie as Greg Maddux from the left side.
Nice compliment. Jamie Moyer, I faced him many times in my playing career, and he's very, very crafty. You can't go up there looking for a fastball. He's going to work around the plate.
Well, a great changeup. In fact, Moyer taught his changeup to Maddux when they were teammates with the Cubs. That is now one of the vintage Maddux offerings. He has Moyer to thank. First ball swinging again. There's an Indian reaching out for the outside corner. That's where Moyer will live all afternoon if you let him.
And if you try to pull that ball, that's what you get. Ground ball to the shortstop or third baseman. Jim Thome stepping in. He used the term, bump him. I'm going to try to bump him. And that means go to the opposite field. As he'll pitch the left-hander the same as a right-hander. He'll work away. He still throws the changeup.
Him with one on the inside edge, 0-1.
You can see that shadow goes right in between the pitcher and hitter. Didn't have a problem. The Mariners didn't have one problem at all that last inning. It's not so much that particular time of the day. It's when the shadow goes past the pitcher. And the pitcher and hitter are both in the shadows where that ball comes out of that backdrop. Dark and gray. It's hard to see.
Ken Griffey Jr. called Moyer Bugs Bunny, referring to that classic cartoon where Bugs the pitcher strikes out the big bad hitter with a super slow. That's what we saw right there.
Nice little curveball. It's a slow one. Tomey's only 5 for 28 with one home run in his career off Moyer.
You thinking another one of those Bugs Bunny breaking balls here?
It'd be nice if he could. Well, with two strikes here, Tomey's going to try to bump him just like he said. And for to hear Jim Tomey use the term bump, I laughed at him. I said, come on, man. Only bumps you look for are those ones way deep in the second or third deck. He's a real power hitter.
Came back with some more Bugs Bunny, but we cannot use the catchphrase, ba-dee-ba-dee. That's all, folks, quite yet. 3-2.
There's Moyer's right-handed. 235, left-handers 252. Right around the same, not very good either side.
Got him! That wascally wabbit has done it again.
Mom, how many times?
Done.
Moyer pitching a shutout. In fact, has not allowed a base runner yet. The Cleveland Indians up 1-0 in the series by virtue of a 5-0 win yesterday. Bartolo Colon was the guy that we talked so glowingly about all day.
It was Chuck Finley's daughter there. She's a beauty. Winter and Rainy are his two girls.
No Autumn?
Not yet.
David Bell tails one in the center. Now, I mentioned Chuck Finley in a big game today, obviously, and coming up tonight on Fox. Pretty big one for the Yankees as they will look to rally game two of the division series. Jason Giambi and the A's against Derek Jeter. And the New York Yankees, Tim Hudson and Andy Pettit, your pitching matchup. The road to the World Series continues tonight on Fox. 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. Boy, Oakland looks pretty darn good. They have won 63 out of their last 81, Hutt, including last night.
Terrence Long, go ahead. Giambi, you know, off the top of the upper deck. Oakland sending a message. They're much better than they were last year, and Joe Torre knows it. But Finley there towards the end of the inning, starting to settle down in that first. Retiring Olerud, Buehner, and Wilson all in order. He's starting to keep the ball down and out of the zone.
First pitch strikes to 8 of the 9 that he's faced, too. And there's that splitter to finish up McLemore.
Finley's got it working, but it might be too late. I don't know. If they can handle Moyer, figure him out. So he's got it working. 3 strikeouts now. In the last 5 batters.
This will present a challenge, though. Ichiro struck out only 56 times during the regular season. That's in about 700 at-bats. To right field. It's deep. Not deep enough. That would have brought the house down here in Seattle. It's 4-0 Mariners at the end of 2.
To stay out of jail.
55 degrees and perfect here in Seattle today. The original forecast was for rain. Right now, it's the Jamie Moyer show. He has been perfect through 2. He goes after Freeman, Cordova, and Dion with his Mariners up by 4. Suddenly, his Cleveland team needing to roller skate uphill a little bit, something I actually saw someone do here in Seattle yesterday. A
lot of hills. especially in baseball, and facing Moyer down 4-0. Moyer will continue to work the outer half of the plate. Challenge the hitters. If you try to pull him, you better catch it just right or you'll hit a ground ball on the left side. If you have success off Moyer, you get a few hitters, go to right field with a few singles, and get Moyer trying to come more on the inside plate to knock him off. Dan Wilson doing a fine job of trying to frame that pitch up on the outside corner. Good receiver. Underrated, in my opinion. Blocks balls well and the plate. Runners come home.
There's one inside. Lyman nails it foul. Now, you had three home runs in your day off Jamie Moyer. Was that your secret to move up? You just look to take the ball up the middle?
Exactly. You crowd him up. You know, he's not going to hurt you with his 85-mile-an-hour fastball if he does come inside. So I would say, hey, I would just spit on that and look for all of his off-speed pitches. And because I moved up 2 or 3 inches, that meant that the meat of my bat was on the outside part of the plate. So when he put that change up there, I wasn't looking to hit him to right. I was looking to take him deep. I wasn't a real home run hitter, but I only played once a week.
Outside corner. Good night, Travis Ryman. Second strikeout for Moyer.
The previous pitch was inside, and that set this pitch up away. Right on the corner.
Near the corner.
Well, sometimes the angle's deceiving. Ted Barrett has the best angle back there. He's the home plate umpire. So far, he's looked like he's been pretty fair.
We talked about it. Moyer needing an umpire with a generous strike zone on the outside part of the plate. Make that changeup. Get called a strike without any problem. There's the strike.
That's the big slow curve. Lots of times, if he starts you with one curve and throws it for a strike, he'll come right back with another one. Maybe a little lower out of the zone.
I'll tell you, Jamie Moyer, the living proof, Hud, of the old Branch Rickey maxim, luck being the residue of design. He succeeds because he prepares. Maybe more than anybody else inside of Curt Schilling in the game. Every year updating a thick spiral notebook with his thoughts on every batter he's faced over the last 10 years. And he scouts the umpires too. He knows what he can get away with, what he can't. He has faced Cordova only a handful of times, but every at bat well documented in that notebook.
Cordova, 8-for-27. Lifetime off of Jamie Moyer with 2 big fly home runs. So most of these hitters have a good idea of the pitcher and Jamie Moyer. He said how Moyer scouts the hitters. Well, the hitters scout the pitching too. And that plate is only 17 inches wide. And you got to be pretty good to keep it out of that middle. Good hitters look for that half inch mistake.
Trying to outfox Cordova here for the second out of the inning. Trying to get what he got a few pitches ago.
Barrett's got his work cut out for him today. Middle away. And I saw him before when they were passing the lineup cards out at home plate. Ted Barrett with his foot was brushing off the outside and inside parts of the plate. Here it is again. Moyer just a little bit further outside.
Barrett may as well have left the inside part of the plate covered with dirt. Doesn't look like Moyer needs it.
That's right, but he's got good balance. You saw his delivery right there. Comes over the top most of the time. Sometimes he'll drop down for effect.
Diaz chasing on the outside corner.
Aynar Diaz, 1-for-9 with 1 homer in his career off Moyer. I'll let you know what all the hitters are hitting off of him the first time around.
Now coming in, and Diaz will poke it into right center. There's the first base runner for Cleveland today. Indians, remember yesterday, got most of their thump from the bottom of the lineup.
Let's see now. Diaz, they're setting up in, and Moyer missed. He missed out over the plate. That's what happens. Hitters will take advantage if you miss. Wilson wanted that one in tight on it.
Third baseman Bell in on the grass, not ruling out a bunt possibility from Lawson. He's not bunting. He drives it to right. But there's Ichiro. Jamie Moyer, a one-hitter through three. Cameron's already homered for Seattle. Here he comes. First inning home runs, two-run shots both. Have the Mariners out in front today, 4-0, game two. And yeah, Hamrin, Mike Cameron, one of the two home runs, Edgar Martinez the other. We talked about it, Hud, kind of a curious choice for a number two hitter today. Cameron, one of 17 lifetime against Finley. Eight strikeouts. He did not miss, though, getting a fastball in the first.
But you mentioned it. He's a good fastball hitter with Ichiro on first base. He got one right there out over the middle. He had a little hop. That'll tell you he knew he got it. That's the one nice thing about a player when he hits a home run. If he hits it well, he alone knows how he hit it. He knows it's a home run before anybody else does.
Cameron enjoying that feeling 25 times during the regular season. The one thing left to make it a complete season, that would be if he could shave the strikeout total down. Struck out three times yesterday or on Tuesday.
And we talked to him, and he knows that that's an area in his game that can improve that in his batting average. On the season, Cameron hit 267.
Slapping that one to third, big tidy hop for Freiman. Great year for Mike Cameron, though. We talked to him about it.
RBIs came because of the opportunities I had, and I was hit well with runners in score position. Home runs are something that I'm capable of because of what my body is able to produce. Average and the other things are, I feel like I can improve on that by just knowledge and putting a better swing on the ball on a day-to-day basis.
Brett Boone sweeping one to third. Remember when the Mariners traded Griffey to Cincinnati, Hud? They didn't want Cameron in return. They were holding out for Pogi Reese to play second base. Now, not only are they thrilled with Cameron, but because they didn't get Reese, they signed Brett Boone. So it all worked out okay.
That's right. That's, general managers have a tough job. But, you know, they can't replace Alex Rodriguez, Ken Griffey Jr., Randy Johnson. You can't replace players like that. So what you do is you try to find a player who's going to come in and do something extra, something special that one of those players didn't do. Set the table, move the runners, little things.
Here's a guy that's had a chance for free agency and has said, no, thank you. I like Seattle just fine. That's Edgar Martinez. In fact, only Barry Larkin of the Reds has been with his team longer than any active player now that Quinn's retired, now that Ripken's retired.
That was a pretty good pitch on the outside part of the plate. Moyer's been getting that. Finley didn't get that one.
Another chance for Freiman at third. It's an all Travis Freiman inning. 5-3 bounce outs all the way. End of three, Seattle 5-4.
With the crisp, clean, refreshing taste you'll find in no other beer. This Bud's for you.
Well, the Seattle Mariners 0 for 10 yesterday with men on base. Find themselves 2 for 2 today. That game Tuesday, they just could not get anything going against Bartolo Colon. But they found something with Chuck Finley early on today. Although, to Finley's credit, he is now retired 9 straight. He has kept this game 4-0.
Well, the difference between Bartolo and Finley is Colon, he wasn't missing out over the plate. He was hitting his spots on inside, outside, up and down. And Finley missed over the plate. And like I said before, good hitters won't miss, especially in playoff games of this magnitude.
Omar Vizquel, once a very popular player here in Seattle, still getting a smattering of boos directed his way because of Earring Gate from a couple months ago.
Earring Gate. That's what it was.
All the talk about too much dazzle, too much sparkle off Arthur Rhodes' earrings. Yesterday's gem belonged to Bartolo Colon. 8 innings, no runs, 10 strikeouts.
Corners are in. Olerud, Bell. They're in because Vizquel can handle that bat. He's not afraid to bunt.
Keep in mind that this is precisely the point of the game on Tuesday where Cleveland was able to break through. There was a 20-pitch period where Freddie Garcia just kind of fell out of it. 6 base runners, 3 runs scored over 20 pitches.
In today's game, it was Chuck Finley who had a tough time in the first getting all of his pitches gauged properly.
That's ball 4. And the first walk allowed by Jamie Moyer. We invite you to go to MLB.com to bid on special autographed and game-used items currently up for auction to benefit the Disaster Relief Fund. By the way, for more information on some of the statistics you're hearing about today, you can log on to WorldSeries.com.
Situation here, nobody on. Vizquel at first base. Alomar might give him a chance to steal.
And Hunt, one other flashback to the top of the fourth inning from Tuesday's game. There was some cloud cover that kind of descended on top of things here in Seattle. All those shadows that we talked about weren't much of an issue in that 3-run top of the fourth on Tuesday. This inning began with a little cloud cover. And again, the point that the hitters were making, it was just so much easier to see the ball coming in when there wasn't that stark contrast, the bright sunshine and the dark shadows.
These are all the elements of the game that baseball offers from time to time, park to park, city to city. I mean, you have to just play the elements.
Now you see the sun coming back a little bit. Sun has been playing hide and seek with the clouds pretty much all day. And again, there was a lot of speculation that no matter what, maybe it would be in the Mariners' best interest to just slide this puppy shut today. It did not happen.
Well, we talked with Lou Piniella. Lou was just kind of laughing it off. Matter of fact, he said the fans like it open. Didn't even mention the fact. And what that told me was Lou Piniella is very confident in this team. He was very relaxed in his office, feet up on his desk. Well, he's been through this many times before. World champion Cincinnati Reds, the National League. Lou is definitely one of the best American League managers today. Now Moyer's trying to pitch more inside to Alomar as he knows the situational hitter that Alomar is. He's a smart hitter. If Moyer tries to peck him away on the outside corner, Alomar simply go with it and try to move Vizquel all the way to third base. Even though in right field, Ichiro possesses one of the finest throwing arms in the game. He's shown that all year long.
Alomar stretching out. And curls it right to Ichiro for the out. Jamie Moyer, keep in mind, was 11-1 in his final 12 decisions at a 2.2 ERA after the All-Star break. He continues to dominate this very impressive Cleveland Indian lineup. This is including today. Guys allowed 6 hits and 17-plus innings. That's to an Indians team that features Alomar, Gonzalez, Tomey, Lofton, and Vizquel setting those guys up.
That's right, and 14 strikeouts, 17 2/3, pretty impressive for a soft tosser. He's not a power pitcher, but he sure will make you have fits if you face him.
Moyer was flat out released by the Baltimore Orioles in 1995. Since since the O's told him to take a hike, he has gone 92 and 41.
When he was with the Chicago Cubs, they were trying to talk him into accepting a coaching position at 27 years old. He said, I think I'll keep pitching.
7-1 with Boston and now 85-40 with Seattle, so 92-41 since he left the Orioles. Supposedly, Michelangelo's David was carved from a stone first rejected by another sculptor. Moyer likes to tell that story. 1-1 to count to Gonzalez. Not too many major league players know who Michelangelo is.
That's right. He was a fine sculptor.
Jamie Moyer, more of a chiseler. Outside corner's a specialty.
That's right. Now, what makes Gonzalez so dangerous is the fact that he's a bat ball hitter. He doesn't have to hit a ball down the middle. He can reach out and touch you and hit you for a home run just about any part of the ballpark. He doesn't have to be there. Up, down, out, or in. And for Moyer to be successful, he's got to do just that. He's got to come in and show that pitch inside to those hitters. Sets up everything else away. Gale seems pretty comfortable staying home at first base. Doesn't look like he's in the stealing mode. You don't want to take a chance of running to an out with these home run hitters coming up. Gonzalez and Burks.
Steal totals were down for both Lawson and Vizquel this year. Lawson 16, Vizquel 13. But yeah, why run when you've got Gonzalez and Tomey and Burks coming up? Slammed off the back of the mound in a center base hit, Gonzalez. And the best contact that a Cleveland Indian has made today off Jamie Moyer.
Wilson sitting right in the middle of the plate. It was even a better pitch a little bit off. And like I said before, doesn't have to be down the middle. Gonzalez will hit you. Just what he did.
Burks, 3 out of 4 yesterday, one of the hitting heroes for Cleveland. And what again was a 5-0 win. Most of the damage coming in this, the top of the fourth. But Burks did his damage late on Tuesday. That was the capper to the 5-0 win.
A sinker by Peñagua that didn't sink as low as he wanted it to.
Too low, Burks can get the Indians right back in it.
Moyer would love to entice Burks to hit a ground ball to the left side like he did in the first inning for a pitcher's best friend, the double play. One pitch, two outs. Straight away in center field is Cameron. Ichiro deep in right.
And Ichiro in pursuit at the warning track makes the catch. First and third, two out, and the inning left to Tomey.
Burks took a shot. It was middle away. Kept his hands inside. Look at Ichiro. Very comfortable out there. Fine athlete. Didn't get twisted around. Now look at Alomar going back to the base. No problem. He knows it's deep enough for Vizquel. Excuse me. He'll make the tag and come over easily with two outs. Moyer now with a chance to get out of this trouble.
Trouble is he's facing a guy that has launched 8 home runs in his last 10 postseason games. Jim Tomey. One of only a couple guys out there today that doesn't have the sleeves working under the jersey. 55 degree weather.
Good
tough,
old,
tough guy.
Good old country boy. And the tester, there's Burks was going sleeveless. Chester, for a left-handed batter facing a guy like Moyer, is to keep that front shoulder in. Tendency is to kind of open that shoulder when the big curveball comes, and you pull off, hit ground balls. First pitch was a curveball away outside. He sets it up for the fastball at 86. It looks more like 96.
Moyer, distracted by Vizquel, who keeps dancing off the bag at third. Moyer kind of glowering at him.
Well, David Bell's way off the base, the third baseman. He's giving him plenty of time, and that's getting on Moyer's nerves. I mean, you never know. Vizquel has the speed to take off and steal home. The two outs here, you got to question it, though. You really have to have a lot of courage to make an attempt to straight steal a home.
People groan all at once. There it was.
Look at Dan Wilson moving away outside, and he made it look good, but Ted Barrett was on it. His head, look at Barrett's head, right on the outside part of the plate.
Barrett, a former amateur boxer, too. Don't mess with him, right?
Ted's a great guy. Has fun, loves umpiring. All these umpires really enjoy their work. They get in shape, they work out just like the players do. Some need to mix in a salad more than others, I'll tell you, but still.
Two and two, two on, two out. Guy, Tommy, sleeveless in Seattle. And also the guy that could have gotten the Indians right back in it. He tried to, Hud.
Well, Jamie Moyer was eating him up with that high fastball. That's all set up by those curveballs away. Smart pitching. Dan Wilson deserves a lot of that credit.
Strike one to John Olerud, who has had a tough series so far. 0 for 4 Tuesday with three strikeouts, hit into a double play, is fouled out in this one.
Like you said, Finley cruising, retiring his last nine in a row.
That after allowing the first four to reach and score. That's been it today. Seattle, a pair of two-run homers in the first.
Here's Dick Pohl, pitching coach for the Indians.
To the mound, and Finley will make it 10 in a row set down. Now it's Jay Buhner coming up, and a very warm ovation again as Buhner steps in. He's battled foot injuries and returned to the lineup finally this year in September. Had a couple home runs in the final week of the season, played some pretty good defense too. And Lou Piniella, you know, several times the last few years, Jay Buhner could have asked for a trade or signed elsewhere as a free agent. He has stuck it out with Seattle, and today Lou Piniella is sticking with him.
And like Lou said before the game, he's got Buhner in there. He said, hey, maybe he'll pop a couple. That's how he termed it.
Now, he admitted it was a hunch. Lou's saying, I've got a sense of history. Javier kept on the bench with a 323 lifetime average against Finley. What though, so far the hunches haven't been half bad for Lou. Mike Cameron hitting in the two hole today. He produced one of those first inning home runs.
That's right. Good managers will go with that gut feeling. Buhner knows Finley as good as anyone on that team. He's faced him a lot of times in his career. He knows if you don't get him early and he gets ahead, you're going to get that split finger. Just like that.
You know, we talk about Pinella. But only eight teams ever have led their division wire to wire in a regular season. Lou Piniella has managed two of them. 1990 Reds and the Mariners this year.
And with the Reds, he had a solid bullpen, the Nasty Boys. He's got another good one here.
3-2 the count to Buhner. Winner of this series gets the winner of that series. Opened up 1-0 on the Yankees. Breaks a string of 10 straight that Finley had retired consecutively. Second walk allowed today. You know, all through September, Rex, Seattle heard about the 1906 Cubs, the other team with 116 wins. Seattle now in danger of being compared to that team for another reason entirely. The 06 Cubs were unceremoniously dismissed in the postseason. The Mariners felt they really did not want to mess around with answering to that. Not go down 2-0 back to Cleveland.
Well, it just tells you what you do during the season doesn't always determine what you're going to do in the postseason.
116 wins in the regular season, not a single one of which helps him now. They got help from that guy today. Two-run first inning a homer. Mike Cameron hit the other. Fastball missing, 2-0 the count to Wilson. The 06 Cubs won 116. They did not beat the crosstown White Sox, the hitless wonders. And yeah, the 54 Indians lost to Willie Mays and the New York Giants. They were swept.
Guarantees.
Not back to the net, 2-1.
Dan Wilson, a good fastball hitter. He full power left field.
Used to have what's called warning track power, but now you're right, those balls that used to die at the track are ending up about five rows back.
Well, that comes with being a veteran, and later in your career you gain natural power, plus with the knowledge of the strike zone, knowing which pitches you can handle and which ones you can't. And that comes with maturity. You have to battle to stay in the game long enough.
To battle through it in the postseason. Dan Wilson pretty embarrassed about how it's gone. He has been in the postseason plenty, but is now 4-for-64 lifetime in the playoffs.
He got a hit off of Cologne 99 miles an hour the other day, the opposite field. That got to make him feel better.
Four for 164, but as long as he's working with Jamie Moyer and these other Seattle pitchers, as well as that's gone this year, Lou Piniella gives him a mulligan on that.
It's all how you can handle the pitching staff. Wilson's done a great job.
And there's enough thunder on top and beneath Wilson in this order, too, to carry it. Play. It is turned, and that is it. Fox Sports, home of the Major League Baseball playoffs and World Series, returns after these messages from your local Fox station. 2-4-0 as we take a look at our MasterCard fan cam. They talk about that Soto Mojo, south of downtown. And if you've seen the Austin Powers movies, you know all about Mojo.
Talk about tough guys. Look at him. She can't bear to watch. Must be a Cleveland fan.
Travis Fryman turned a nice double play to help Cleveland out of the bottom of the fourth. Here he is to lead off the fifth. Gets a lollipop. Outside corner, strike one.
Yeah, Fryman turned that hard line drive, hit at him into a marshmallow, and went ahead and went around the horn with a nice double play. Helped out Chuck Finley.
Finley and Moyer, neither of today's starters, a member of Generation X. L or M, probably more like it. Here's the double play.
Wilson just powdered it. Fryman, no problem. Short hop pick. Alomar, quick turn at second.
Fryman nailing that one right to Ichiro. One down and time for a game break. Let's go to Genie's Alaska in L.A.
Hello, Josh. In the home of the Bronx Bombers, it was the new Bash Brothers that went off last night. Terrence Longhorn was not one, but twice. Jason Giambi added insult to injury, and the A's grabbed game one tonight on the Fox Network game two, and Pettit versus Tim Hudson. You can follow the entire tourney exclusively on the Fox Networks, Josh.
Jeannie, thank you. Love that. I love the brackets we've been seeing, too. It really does look like a tourney. Cordova behind in the count, 0-1. And the A's, I mean, if you want to make it like your March Madness brackets, so they'd be that team that finished really strong, came out of a really good conference. And they're the trendy pick, you know? Back to the mound, Moyer's got it. The brackets that we're speaking of, and again, the winner of Cleveland-Seattle advances to take on the winner of Stanford and East Tennessee. No, wait a minute, Oakland and the Yankees. Atlanta, Houston, and the Braves going home to try to finish it up. But keep in mind, the Braves had a terrible time winning games at home this year. Our best wishes to Bobby Cox. He may not be with the team for game three. His sister is taken ill. But you can follow that entire tournament, if you will, on Fox Family and on Fox right to the last out of the World Series. Diaz, hello. Moyer dropping one in down around his shins, and it's 1-1.
He has got the Indians in that hit column first. There with a base hit. His first at-bats, looking to stay hot at 2-for-2.
Just off the outside corner, 2-1.
So Barrett's, you know, there's been a couple pitches on the outside corner that he didn't give Finley, and now there's one for Moyer, so he's trying to be as neutral as possible. It's not easy. Work that plate, both sides. Good Dan Wilson peek into the hitter. Lots of times good catchers, they'll tell by the hitter's body language what he might be looking for.
Staying away from Diaz, remember Moyer came in a bit on Diaz in the third inning, and Anar deposited one in right center for a single. That was the first hit for Cleveland today. One of their two. In the left, and Buehner paddling the glare of the sun. It stays a two-hit shutout for Jamie Moyer. Halfway home in game two, 4-0 to score.
The cure for the common car.
Snoqualmie Falls, just a little bit away from downtown Seattle. You know who I went there with once? Kurt Gibson.
Wow.
So I do the games with back in Detroit. He gathered up everybody and said, come on, we're going to go see the falls.
Did he throw any rocks?
no, almost a couple of people, but cooler heads prevailed. Talk about some playoff heroes. And obviously, Kurt Gibson was one in 1988. But the Dodgers against the A's, and you're wondering now who emerges out of this series as the hero. Yesterday, Bartolo Colon put in the first claim, 8 innings of shutout ball. Jamie Moyer is dominating here in game two, 4-0 Seattle. Chuck Finley in too snug to David Bell.
Bell led off the second inning with a nice line drive to the center fielder, but it was caught. See if he can do better this time.
Finley opened this game with 4 runs in before there was an out. David Risky has gotten up in the bullpen. There was no action in the bullpen as Finley was struggling those first 15 pitches of the game. Clobbers it to left. Gone! Our director was not the only one wanting to show you the bullpen. David Bell just found it too.
That's right. Finley put one down at the knees, but it was out over the middle of the plate, and Bell got the back underside of that ball and sent it over Cordova and the wall for his first postseason home run.
David Bell, whose dad, Buddy, played for 18 years in the big leagues, never got a sniff of the postseason. Son hits a home run in the fifth here in game two. Seattle leading by the score by which they lost yesterday, 5-0. Mark McLemore today relegated to the role of, well, the comedian you have to sit through before Springsteen comes on stage. Ichiro is next.
That's right, but you know, Seattle has done a great job of capitalizing on Finley's mistakes. Haven't missed one.
And it is amazing, too, to watch. Here's McLemore at the plate, working the count as he always does, 2-2. And you get the sense no one's watching him in this ballpark. You're watching Ichiro limber up. Gell, quick release. McLemore is out by half a step.
McLemore runs well out of the box. He knows that once he makes contact, he becomes a track star. And here he goes. Fryman was going to try to get it, but Piscale called him off. Barely got him. Third baseman normally try to come in there and make that play if they can, anything in front of the shortstop. But Piscale knows the importance of communication, and he let Fryman know to back off it.
Ichiro. And it really doesn't matter that there's been little communication between Ichiro and the fans. They love him anyway.
Well, how can they not? I mean, he's just a real talented, gifted ball player in his first full season in the majors. No doubt will be Rookie of the Year, possibly MVP, all in one, a la Freddie Lynn.
And you know what, when he does say something, there's kind of a Garbo Speaks quality to it. He's so cool and so mysterious, maybe not even in that order. When you think about it, this guy was brand new on the scene, but he was a recipient of 3.4 million All-Star votes this summer. That's exceeding the population of two dozen U.S. states.
Yeah, well, you know, when you open it up to Japan and Australia, especially Japan, for voting, you're going to see that.
Well, he ended the year with 36 more hits than any other major league player. And the interest in him globally is phenomenal.
What I like about him, he's put Major League Baseball on the worldwide map.
September 29th against Oakland. Hit number 234. That set a new Major League rookie record. They all, a lot of them, these base hits. You just kind of step back and say, all right, yeah, he's got a tennis racket in that hand. He's serving it wherever he wants to. Paddling the ball to left, to center. A single here, and that's going to be it for Chuck Finley. He waited 15 years for this moment, and it did not go very well. He wanted to come to Cleveland because he figured he would be in the playoffs. The Indians didn't trade for a veteran starter at the All-Star break or thereabouts because they figured Finley would be plenty for them in the playoffs. But in this, his first playoff start, he is done after 4 1/3. And David Riske, who grew up in Renton, Washington, just about 15 miles south from home plate, Lindbergh High, the Lindbergh Aviators. And he is on now to face Mike Cameron, who's already homered today.
Riske. He's got 29 strikeouts. You see that? He uses a fastball, slider, and a split finger for his pitches. His fastball's not overpowering. He can reach 90, 91, 92 miles an hour. We'll have to shorten up his delivery as the Ichiro looks very hungry to steal a bag.
We thought Jamie Moyer was slim, by the way. David Riske, 6'2", 172. Cameron takes the fastball for a strike.
Riske didn't slide step there. He had a high leg kick. Gives the base runner enough time to steal if he wants to.
Has not allowed a run against Seattle this year. Six innings worth of work. Off the lead, but now it's quickly 0-2 to Cameron. Ichiro, 56 stolen bases during the regular season.
There's Johnny Moses over Ichiro's right shoulder. First base coach. Dave Myers, the third base coach, giving the signs to Ichiro.
Over to first. Myers just off that third base coaching box. A great story, Hud. 20 years in the minor league system with the Mariners as a player and a coach. What, did he pick a great year to come up to the big leagues or what? 116 wins.
As a player or a coach, you rarely go through a season like the Mariners have this year. You're right. He picked the right time to make his major league debut.
Cameron ripped and he didn't get it. 92 mile an hour smoke from Riske.
That fastball had some hair on it. Look at that late movement. Started outside, ended up over the middle of the plate. Riske comes right in and throwing darts, not even throwing a ball. He's just coming right after these hitters. That's what you got to do. Get back in that dugout. And Cleveland Indians need to get on the board.
Boone becomes the batter. You've got an MVP candidate leading away at first. You've got an MVP candidate at the plate for Seattle.
Perfect time to steal a base with two outs. Get in scoring position.
Again, Riske has Ichiro very much on his mind.
That's the best thing for a pitcher to do against a base runner is hold that ball. As the base runner, he's like a track runner starting in blocks. You get a little edgy, a little jumpy, and you're waiting for that sound to go for the movement in the pitcher. And then he steps off.
Strike one called to Boone. Now what do you think, Cut? We talk about this MVP possibility. You know Ichiro's going to be the rookie of the year. He also grant him MVP honors, or do you let Boone or maybe Jason Giambi fight for that, or maybe one of these Indians?
Well, the fact that Lou Piniella talked about Ichiro as a possible MVP candidate would stroke, I mean, it sounded volumes for Ichiro in that MVP department. I think Boone's had an MVP-type season for a second baseman. He's put up numbers that no American League second baseman ever has. It's been a huge lift for his team in Alex Rodriguez's absence.
There goes Ichiro. Swing and a miss, and the throw down by Diaz, not in time.
Ichiro with a nice break, got away quickly. Einar Diaz with a nice catch and throw right on the base, but just too late. Ichiro again outran the baseball. Watch that perfect jump. Risky with no slide step. He uses a high leg kick, and that allowed him to get in there.
Risky gets it done, but the Mariners did some more home run hitting in the fifth. David Bell, a solo shot. Top of the order coming for Cleveland. It is now 5-0.
Farm is there.
In Seattle, where this series, best of five series, has been officially turned inside out. Game one Tuesday, Cleveland 5-0. Cleveland playing little ball to score runs. Today, Seattle 5-0 with the home run ball. That's one of those Willy Wonka strike that reverse it deals.
That's right, but Josh, in the playoffs, you just never know. I mean, Cleveland comes in with the big bombers, all or nothing. And there's Stanley Javier going to spell Jay Buhner in left field. Might be a little better defensively than Jay Buhner at this time in his career.
Lofton didn't like that last call, and he takes a long stroll out of the batter's box. Well, the other inside-out thing about this series, as you look at Lofton's reaction, Colon dominating game one, throwing 99. That's about as fast as Moyer can get it in there, 84.
It's all effect. When you throw that slow curve like Moyer does, you get the batter's eye looking at that, and then he comes in with a fastball, it looks harder. Slow changeup, 76.
Lofton continues to chatter with Ted Barrett. Little loop shot for the out. Cleveland looking to come back here in the sixth inning. Omar Vizquel will try to ignite something. He was the man in the comeback for the ages. Charlie Manuel called this. He said, Omar, you're going to triple into the right field corner. And the Indians, who had trailed 14-2 at one point, tied it and then won it. First time in 76 years a team had overcome a 12-run deficit. And the first time that Lofton had been hoisted upside down by Eddie Tauvinsee ever.
Really kick-started the Tribe's momentum there in August.
Think about it. The Indians had started that month of August, 1-4. They trailed at home 14-2 in game six of the month. What might have become of the Indians if they hadn't rallied on that fateful Sunday night?
No, it's just a game of momentum. They certainly were picked up by that comeback. And of course, the Mariners, what they do the next day, came back and won.
But the Indians, for the most part, got their season right again. Seattle had it right pretty much from April 2. 3-1 to Vizquel. And you know, a couple things broke right for Cleveland this year. The White Sox were clobbered by injuries. Minnesota had a fade for the ages in the second half. Outside corner, 3-2.
There's Moyer's hit me over fastball, 83 miles an hour. Lots of times he relies on the hitter just to get him out, his own self out.
Seen time and again a fastball setting up a proverbial mothball. See if Moyer comes back with a change on Vizquel.
Doesn't matter the count. Moyer has confidence in all of his pitches.
Well, back with a fastball, and it's down in front of Ichiro. Base hit. The one guy that has hit Moyer pretty well, Omar Vizquel. A reminder, coming up tonight over on Fox, Game 2 of the division series between the A's and the Yankees. Jason Giambi, Derek Jeter, and the pitching matchup will be Tim Hudson against Andy Pettit. The road to the World Series continuing tonight on Fox at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. The A's, remember, started this season 2-10. Only the second team ever to start 2-10 and then still make the playoffs. The other, by the way, the 1974 Pirates, rookie year of a guy named Art Howe, who now, of course, is the manager of that Oakland team.
Art Howe being very patient. Same with Billy Beane. Went ahead and added a few quality players.
Pop-up by Alomar. Olerud giving way, and it's collected by Boone.
Moyer again using that fastball effectively on the inside part of the plate. Looks good if you're a hitter. Ball was up, out over a little bit. Wasn't as in as much as Dan Wilson wanted. Still, the effect was there. He jammed it.
Now Gonzalez, who signed when Manny Ramirez walked away to Boston. We mentioned the Red Sox, and that should strike a sour note when they look out there and see Jamie Moyer. The Red Sox send Jamie Moyer packing for Darren Bragg, even up. Moyer winning 20 this year. Bragg played in AAA.
That's hard to tell what a guy's going to do. But when you have a persevering heart, you have some good pitches. You never know if you're a pitcher. Same way with a position player. Only the strong survive this game. You've got to really persevere. And when someone says, hey, go home, we don't want you, you can't put your head down. You have to look up and continue to the next team and thank the people who gave you a uniform. That's all you want as a player, is an opportunity.
Released him. You try to get Moyer to say something bad about Baltimore, he refuses, saying exactly that, Hud. Said, hey, they're the guys that said come on in the first place. No, nobody else did.
That's right, and where players make mistakes lots of times is things don't go their way and they air their dirty laundry to upper management, and that's really not a good thing to do. Heck, you got to suck it up and go move on. If you, in your heart, believe you can still play, you go. Be afraid to thank him. He might come back and get a job with him someday.
Runner goes. And Gonzalez, again, kind of diving after it. He will float it to Ichiro to end the inning. Moyer in total control. 5-0 Seattle. The pitching coach for the Mariners, stage right, Jamie Moyer. The artiste is on the left. Moyer, the three-hit shutout. As we begin the bottom of the sixth inning, Game 2, American League Division Series. Cleveland won Game 1, 5-0. Seattle leads Game 2 by the exact same score. David Riske came on in relief of Chuck Finley last inning. Stays away from Martinez, not a bad idea.
No, because this is what he'll do. If you come out over that plate at all, inside-out swing off Chuck Finley. Sent the crowd into a frenzy.
And again, inside out is the hyphenated word of the day. The Mariners are playing Indian-style baseball today, hitting a home run. The Game 1 victory to Cleveland, they did it playing Seattle-style baseball with walks and singles. Risky guiding one over the outside black, 2-2.
Risky's, he's very sneaky. Threw six pitches when he relieved Chuck Finley, all for strikes. Faces Edgar, first pitch, throws him a slider out of respect. Missed for a ball, and then he's evened it up 2-2.
The
good movement on his fastball. He possesses a nice split finger.
Jay Buhner has stuck around here in Seattle. Through the good, bad, and the ugly, so is the guy at the plate, Edgar Martinez. Buhner saying Edgar understands his swing better than anyone in baseball, Hud. It's perfect, but he's still always trying to get more out of it.
Edgar's the finest right-handed batter I ever played against. He's just a great situational hitter.
Fastball gets him here. One down, sixth inning. Fox Family presenting tonight Mel Brooks' Robin Hood Men in Tights. A thrilling tale about a band of merry, manly men, pretty much in ladies' underwear. Tonight at 8, 7 Central. It's good to be the king.
I'll have to check that out.
You can do a lot worse than Mel Brooks Theater, boy. John Olerud takes down and in.
Olerud, a popular player in these areas here. He's got another nice ovation coming to the plate.
Yep, hometown guy. Facing another native of the area, David Riske, on the mound. And Hud, you talked about it on Tuesday. With a lot of guys, you can pencil them in for a certain kind of season. With Olerud, pretty safe to break out a pen. 300 batting average, 20 or so home runs, 100 RBI, 100 walks.
Soft hands at first base. He's up for another Gold Glove this year.
Sky is that one. Lofton marching in. Not a lot going right for Olerud at the plate in the first two games of his division series.
Well, but this is a tester here. Lofton running hard. Right into the sun.
Buhner's spot in the order, but remember, Javier came on defensively last inning. So another veteran. San Javier came up as a third baseman originally. He was a Yankee teammate of Lou Piniella. 17 years later, Lou has Javier in the lineup, still trying to get a hit or two for him.
That's back when I was in the Yankee family. Stanley and I started together. Lou Piniella was my hitting coach, the New York Yankees. Stanley's had a wonderful career. This is probably it for him.
Yeah, this is the end of the line for Javier. When the Mariners play their last game this fall, Javier calling it a career. And will retire, he tells us, to the tree-growing business. He is in negotiations to purchase 20,000 acres in his native Dominican Republic. He's going to grow 7 million trees. So much for retiring and opening a sports bar like everyone else, you know?
Fantastic. Well, Bartolo Colon grew up throwing rocks at coconuts in the tree. I wonder if there'll be coconut trees. Stanley might just develop some young right and left-handed pitchers.
Down the line, that's a fair ball, Tomey, to Riske. And that'll do it here in the sixth inning. Fox Sports, home of Major League Baseball's playoffs and World Series, returns to Seattle after these messages from your local Fox station. Paul Shuey now goes to work in the Cleveland Indian bullpen. No need to get the bullpen up for Seattle quite yet. Jamie Moyer turning in a Bartolo Colon-style gem today, but a very different path. He's not throwing 99. He is throwing more like 79. But as the pitch count gets up, there will be some action for the first time. Jeff Nelson.
This is really where Lou Piniella likes his team to take off. He's got the lead after six. He's got some strong bullpen guys out there to go ahead and help out Jamie Moyer.
Moyer continues to help himself with first pitch strikes. Burks into center base hit. He had a 3-for-4 day yesterday. First hit this afternoon, or check that 3-for-4 day on Tuesday. Game one of the series. Jim Thome coming up, and he has struggled today against Jamie Moyer.
Moyer's worked him. We'll take a look. Soft away. Hard in. Another fastball. Soft away again. Hard in. Good pattern right there, but that's, of course, been in scoring position, first and third. Just Ellis Burks on first base. We'll see how Moyer decides to pitch to this dangerous home run hitter.
Slapped in a left. He's got a base hit.
There's the bump he was talking about earlier today.
Yep, not trying to jackhammer it out.
I'm going to bump him to left, huh? That's what he told me. Dan Wilson setting up away. First pitch. Jim Thome, perfect swing. Short, sweet to the opposite field. Now, Lou Piniella gets up his main weapons. And that bullpen, he's already made the call.
It's an early call. Mid-80s pitch count for Moyer, who was tremendous. Big ovation for him in Seattle. Jamie Moyer left the mound to a standing ovation here in Seattle. The fans have appreciated his 20-win artistry all year. Today, he got into the seventh inning with the shutout intact. It'll be up to Jeff Nelson to make sure the shutout stays intact. But Jamie Moyer, three starts, regular season, now in the postseason, too. He's not shutting down just any old team. That's the Cleveland Indians.
How about 15 punch-outs for some of that stuff he's throwing up there? Pretty impressive. He's a crafty left-hander who's a very smart pitcher. He'll hand the ball over to Jeff Nelson, who can be extremely tough against right-handers.
And what a different look he will show. Moyer, 5'11", about 170 pounds. Jeff Nelson, 6'8", closer to 240. And awfully tough for right-handers, the way he drops down. He pitched in four of the five games of the division series for the Yankees against Cleveland back in 97, four shutout innings. And stranded all six inherited runners. He inherits two runners here and nobody out.
There's Finley hanging on, hoping the Tribe can come back, but they'll have to do it off Nelson, who has a nice sinking running fastball. He can reach 94 miles an hour. His slider is a sharp, late-breaking frisbee-like action from sidearm. He's got an occasional changeup he'll use. He makes it really difficult on the right-handed batters.
And Thome aboard here. Bottom third of the order up. But we don't dismiss that. Yesterday was the bottom third. Tuesday, the bottom third of the order that really lifted Cleveland.
You can see Nelson keeping an eye on Burks back there. You see that big leg kick by Nelson. Well, when he doesn't use a slide step, he's 1.6 to 1.8 seconds to home plate. And even Ellis Burks could walk into third with those times. But with nobody out here, you can't expect anybody to be trying to steal on any bases. Indians down by five.
Off the corner, 1-1.
Take a look at this high leg kick now. Brings it all the way up. There's that three-quarter sidearm delivery. It's tough for the right-handed batter to keep his front shoulder in. This is the part of the game where it's toughest to see. Pitcher, batter, both are in the shadow, but the hitting background is a glare. Bright colored glare. There it is. High fastball. That was right by Freeman before he could even swing. You'll have a hard time seeing off of Jeff Nelson.
Two balls, two strikes to count. Freeman, a strikeout victim in the third. Line to right in the fifth.
That last base hit by Thome, he's able to match Seattle and hits at five apiece.
Ooh. On appeal. No sale.
Ooh, and it's tough. Irwin Dantley says no he didn't, but got a flinch out of Ted Barrett. Little flinch in back of the plate. Watch him here, the umpire. Ooh, this wasn't sure. He lifted up just a little bit. Ball was a
outside. He did not go as he was able to check his swing.
Full count, two on. Nobody out. Down and outside, they're loaded. Keep in mind in that comeback for the ages that we talked about a little while ago, when the Indians came back from down 12, the inning that really kick-started all that was the seventh. And here we are, three on, none out.
This has been Lou Piniella's strength all year. He had the lead in the sixth inning, he likes his chances. Nelson, Arthur Rhodes, Peniagua, and of course, the closer, Sasaki.
Slider again, down and outside. Here's what we're talking about. Seventh, eighth, and ninth, back came the Tribe.
There's that seventh inning where things got started.
If you want to flash back just to Tuesday, keep in mind it was the bottom of the order that did the damage. Cordova, bouncing ball, McLemore. They got one, they got two. They will gladly exchange the run for the first two outs of the inning.
Nelson jammed Cordova. Took a funny hop. McLemore stayed with it. Shovel pass. Over there to Boone. Sweet turn. They're out of it. Not quite. They got one out to go. But Cordova, look at this concentration by McLemore. He's able to find the grip. Good clean feed. Second baseman or top throw right at the runner's head. That'll get him down.
McLemore, remember, is it short because Carlos Guillen is sick. He has normally been the left fielder. And Boone made the very quick exchange. If he was on the bag, it was for a split second before he got rid of it.
Second baseman know how to use that bag as protection. Like I said, if you want the runner to get down, you just show him that ball, throw right through it.
Again, no swing, says Kerwin Danley.
Look at McLemore. First man sure, second man quick. There's a step and watch him throw. Sidearm right to Olerud.
Boone jumping off that bag like it was a hot plate. Knew he had to get rid of it. Inside corner, one and two. In Seattle, and that is figurative as well, as the Seattle Mariners now feeling pretty good about things, up 5-1 heading into the eighth, but it's a dangerous Cleveland Indian lineup that will still have some time to get back in it. Mariners about to bat in the bottom of the seventh inning, and we'll get you to the Nissan game summary. We counted this as a battle between two 38-year-old lefties born within 8 days of each other. Both of them waiting pretty much a lifetime for this chance today, Finley and Moyer. And Moyer did a little better. Cameron and Martinez, first inning, two-run home runs. Bell added a solo in the fifth. Ellis Burks has had a nice series for Cleveland.
Yep, just the difference was in the run department. Finn made a few mistakes in that first inning, and credit the Seattle Mariners hitters for taking advantage. Brian Price now giving some good words of encouragement to Jeff Nelson.
Nelson came on and actually had to deal with the bases loaded, nobody out. He got a double play to cash in a run. But then a flyout off the bat of Diaz, and that was it. 5-1. And the new pitcher for the Cleveland Indians will be Paul Shuey. They had had some injury problems earlier in the year. In fact, was taking batting practice, of all things, when he got hurt, getting ready for interleague play.
70 punch-outs for Paul Shuey. And Mr. Shuey, he'll throw that good fastball at 95. He's got a curve, slider, changeup, but those once in a while. But that splitter is his devastating strikeout pitch.
The Cleveland comeback so far in this one has been held down to from 5-0 to 5-1. They came back from 12. We've told you ad nauseum back on August the 5th. And we talked to Brett Boone about what that did for him.
As a credit to our team, it was kind of after the game, it was kind of what hit us. And that was the third game of the series. But we woke up the next day, had another game, and we went out and beat them. So I think that just shows the character of this Mariner team. And we've been doing stuff like that all year. I mean, it's a relentless team together.
Now, the Mariners have had some pretty weird things happen to them this year. They've hit into triple plays. They've had a team rally from down 12 on them. But because they had such an incredible record, really starting right from word go, it never really seemed to matter to them. They could just flip that stuff right off the table and get on with their life.
Just what Booney said, really didn't matter. They're just able to let everything run off of their back like water off a duck's back. Same thing, let it go. That's a sign of maturity. You got that man playing for you, Ichiro Suzuki. You got it going. Shuey, when he's on, he's bringing a lot of ground balls. Wilson's hit a couple foul.
Darren Cohn up in the bullpen. It's remarkable to remember back to spring training when Seattle GM Pat Gillick insisted that to get to the playoffs, his team would have to win its division. Wilson launching the left. At the track for the out. Of course, they did win their division by 15 games over a team that won more than 100 times. Pat Gillick, the architect of this team, a man who once had the nickname C-Gap Wally. That's yellow pages backwards, because word was Pat Gillick could memorize a phone book both ways, frontwards and backwards.
Well, that's amazing what he's done here. That's a pretty good memory.
Go slap him on the back. Call. Good to see you, C-Gap.
No, I don't think so. A lot of respect for GMs, as their job is not easy at all. And letting Alex Rodriguez test the market. Quite a challenge for Pat Gillick. He's turned it all around into a magical season.
Well, silly as this may sound, the Mariners truly felt, Gillick truly felt all along, that having lost three of the best players in baseball the last 3 years, Griffey, Randy Johnson, and A-Rod, they were in the best shape they've been to go to a World Series. If they get there, they'll have done it because they did it differently than the rest of their neighbors. Everyone else in the AL West went for offense and then more offense. The Mariners keyed in on defense and pitching. Gillick saying what's good enough for the Yankees, probably good enough for us too. The Yankees have won with pitching and defense and a superior closer. And that's what we've got now too.
Kazuhiro Sasaki waiting his turn.
Bell hit it off his shoe top into left field. That was Ichiro-esque.
That's right. He followed up after that big home run with a nice, crisp line drive single. Between Vizquel and Freiman, there it was, hit it hard. 2-3 hopper, no chance for Vizquel. David Bell looks like he's recovered from that rib cage injury he had a week before the season ended.
McLemore, not a lot of offense, but he's been perfect with the glove. You know, talking about GMs, too, the Cleveland GM is John Hart. Mark McLemore telling us he really owes a debt of gratitude to John Hart. McLemore was with the Indians in 1990, but he was blocked by Carlos Baerga. John Hart called to Houston, said, I really like this guy McLemore. I've just got no room for him. Can you give him a gig? And McLemore began to resurrect his career pretty much the following year. So you look at the record books, it says that the Indians pretty much just released McLemore after 12 at-bats. You'd assume there's some bitterness there, but not at all.
And here's another veteran player who gets it. He believes in his talent. He's confident. He says, hey, thanks. I'll see you down the road. Appreciate you letting me go. Lou Piniella, he loves it. How could you not? He's done everything he can. They were going to try to make a player move in spring training to try to find another shortstop. It's the injury history of Carlos Guillen. And they said, ah, let's watch McLemore play shortstop. And in two games starting at shortstop, McLemore was fielded flawlessly and made some spectacular plays. And Lou says, hey, look, here's our guy. Let's save a roster move. Credit McLemore for his hard work doing what he's doing this year.
Down in the count here, 1-2.
Josh, all these ball players work hard. I mean, to play Major League Baseball at the highest level like this, you just can't push a button and turn a switch on. You have to do off-season training, preparation, lots of batting practice, time and time, repetition. I mean, golfers take a lot of time on the practice tee. These baseball players, these hitters, they're hitting all the time. Repetition. Work on their bodies. Get strong. Endure a 162-game season.
Conversation on the mound. We go quickly. Actually, we will do that a little bit later. Get you caught up on some things.
We go quickly to Edgar.
We were just not quick enough.
It's okay. There's Edgar and Stanley, two veteran players. And veteran players get it done in postseason. Managers and GMs will tell you that.
Well, just what you were talking about, Edgar Martinez, a terrific emblem of that. 2 days after Edgar's season is over, it's back to his training regimen. Most guys wait, I would figure, a couple weeks at least. Edgar allows himself 48 hours, and that's it. Time to go to work.
When you're over 35, you can't afford to take any time. I remember when I was young, 20s, my low 20s, heck, I just Cadillac through the offseason. You know, when you start getting up there, you really got to do a lot for the body. Like I said, 162-game season. And veteran players, if you're considered a success in the game, if you hit 300, well, that's failing 7 out of 10 times. You have to really learn how to condition yourself for failure. It's a mental game.
Chewy strikes out McLemore. And now, not so quickly, a game break. We go to Genie's Alaska in L.A.
Whenever you're ready, Josh, we're waiting for you. No matter what happened in Game 1 of their division series, the Yankees feel good going into Game 2 against the A's. Andy Pettitte, one of the best pitchers in recent postseason history. Yankees 15-4 when he starts. Tim Hudson won't make it easy. He has the best record as a starter since he became a starter with at least 50 starts. Look for tonight on Fox, Josh.
All right, Jeannie, thank you. That was worth getting to you. That is going to be fun to watch tonight. Andy Pettitte came up huge in Game 2 last year in the division series. That against the Oakland A's. That series ended up going 5.
Joe Buck and Tim McCarver, they are right on every call. I enjoy listening to them.
Ichiro twisting that one foul as 0-2. Ichiro, 4 hits in this series already.
Well, watch this falling away style. Typical Ichiro. Look at how he's falling away. His body's going one way. His bat goes the other. Arthur Rhodes getting it ready. Left-handed strongman.
Shortstop side. You got to hurry. Ichiro is out by half a step. Vizquel getting it done. So now at the end of 7, top of the order coming up for Cleveland as we get to the 8th on Fox Family. In Seattle, where the Mariners are trying to even this best-of-5 series, 1 game apiece. Josh Lewin, Rex Hudler, nice to have you with us here on Fox Family. Arthur Rhodes is coming on. The 8th inning has been his domain. 8 is the number of wins. 1.72 ERA.
Arthur absolutely gets it done. That's an overpowering fastball at 96 miles an hour. He's got a sharp slider. He'll throw at 83. Occasional changeup. He's got some curve because he used to start. He's got all four weapons, but when you've got that real hard fastball, that's what you go with most of the time.
Kenny Lofton, hitless in this series, but does have a game-winning hit off Arthur Rhodes this year. Pretty good numbers lifetime, in fact, for Lofton off of Rhodes. 7 out of 16.
You pretty much know what you're expecting when you're facing Arthur. Hard, heavy fastball.
And a pair of sparkling earrings. It will be of great interest to the man on deck. Popped away foul. Lofton followed by Omar Vizquel.
You can see that hitter. He doesn't have much time, Kenny Lofton, to determine if that pitch is going to be a strike or a ball. It's on you that quick. That's how quickly you have to make up your mind. Not easy.
One down, and now the fans get to savor the irony of Rhodes against Vizquel with the earrings on. Vizquel wanted them removed. In August, Arthur Rhodes didn't want to give him up. Tim McClelland eventually asked Rhodes to simply leave the game.
The sun was shining a little bit differently. It was earlier in the ball game. But now, the shadow is way past Rhodes, and we've got a little cloud cover here, and no confrontation.
Rhodes is dominated. Vizquel slapping that one foul. He is just 1-for-22 is Omar Vizquel against Arthur Rhodes. But Vizquel trying to get the last word in back on August 25th. And yeah, they, I would say, remember here in Seattle. Very, very cute, ladies.
That's great. Look at him. Oh, blinded by the light. Fastball. When you hit that off the end of your bat, it feels like a shot put you just hit. And it's very difficult.
Two and two.
Lou Piniella likes it. Brings in Jeff Nelson, Arthur Rhodes, and then Kazuhiro Sasaki, who's loosening in the bullpen.
Alomar, the batter. Olerud chasing. And it looks like neither rain nor sleet nor snow nor earrings. Slowing down Seattle today. 5-1 lead, bottom of the eighth coming up.
For business to the next level.
In Seattle, 5-1 lead for the Seattle Mariners, getting to the bottom of the eighth. And Seattle looking to get this series even up 1-1. This copyrighted telecast presented by authority of the Commissioner of Baseball. It may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form. The accounts and descriptions of this game may not be disseminated without express written consent. Now tomorrow, keep in mind, another full day of baseball. It starts on Fox at 4 Eastern, 1 Pacific, Game 3 of the Division Series. Jeff Bagwell and the Astros trying to stay alive against Chipper Jones and the Braves. Then here on Fox Family at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific, Diamondbacks and Cardinals, Game 3 of their series, presented by Budweiser. The road to the World Series continuing tomorrow across the Fox networks. And don't forget the Yankees and A's on Fox tonight. Game 2, Oakland leading there 1-0. Danny Baez in the bottom of the eighth. Third pitcher used by Charlie Manuel today.
They really like Baez. He's got a good overpowering fastball in the mid-90s. Curveball, split finger, occasional slider, an occasional changeup. Mainly, he's coming right after these guys out of the bullpen. He's got a live arm. They're not sure exactly what they're going to do with Baez. They'd like to make him a starter next year or possibly use him in long relief.
Seattle, a believer. He's pitched well against the Mariners. We're talking about the Astros being down two. It is not impossible. It is improbable, but here are the comebacks from down 0-2 in a best-of-five series. LCS or LDS. Mariners and Indians both involved in the division series. They're getting all of it done on the plus side at home. Houston's got to go on the road for two.
Know in the game of baseball.
Well, the Astros had the best road record in the National League. The Atlanta Braves became the first team in a non-strike shortened season to have a losing record at home and still make the playoffs. So not a done deal. It'll be Reynolds against Birkin. 4 o'clock tomorrow Eastern time on Fox. Cameron disposed of.
Wow, Baez just hitting that low outside corner with that 93.4 mile an hour gas. There it is. Anar Diaz, the catcher, never moved. Right off of that spot. Outside, low and away. Almost unhittable.
Brett Boone, number three in the order, was a cleanup hitter for the American League at the All-Star Game. Played right here in Seattle. Most of the year, Boone's been hitting fifth for Lou Piniella, so how about that? You get to hit cleanup for the All-Star team. But on Seattle, you're only good enough to go fifth.
Ooh. That pitcher, Baez, or whoever it is, keeps that ball down below the knees with that type of velocity. Makes it really hard on that hitter.
Winning Tuesday's game, getting 11 hits. There have been 11 hits total in this game today. Six by the Mariners, five by Cleveland. Three of the Seattle hits left the yard. Two-run home run by Cameron in the first inning. Two-run home run by Martinez in the first inning. Bell added a solo in the fifth. In the air to center. Lofton couldn't find it for a moment, and now he's tracking it. Two down. And that's the Brett Boone that Lou Piniella had in Cincinnati about 10 years ago. Ball up around your neck. Go ahead, swing at it anyway.
That's right. Well, Baez, it's the first time he's missed. And you can see Boone got a piece of it up. Down low, Baez is unhittable.
Martinez, the home run today, and of all things on Tuesday, had a stolen base.
The least expected guy out there to steal a bag was Martinez, and he did it.
Of course, yep, it's a game that featured Ichiro getting picked off and Edgar successfully stealing second.
Yeah, but the difference between Ichiro and Edgar was they hold Ichiro on. Edgar, first baseman Jim Thome, was back about 20, 30 feet. Wasn't even close to him. He was able to get a good walking lead. Day he ran pretty well. Now he makes an excellent designated hitter. A role reserved for veteran hitters.
Curling away from Lofton, who makes the catch anyway. Tremendous diving play to set up the ninth inning. It'll be Gonzalez, Burks, and Tomey, some home run hitters. 5-1 Seattle. Away from tying this best of five ALDS at one game apiece, the Seattle Mariners bring on the closer, Kazuhiro Sasaki.
Kazuhiro, he has gotten the job done with 45 saves this year. It's been fantastic. But you know, there, you can find a kink in the armor. You can see he's 0-4 and he's blown seven saves this year, but still he has been an excellent closer for the Mariners.
By the way, the coordinating producer of Fox Baseball, Michael Weissman, today's game produced by Carol Langley McDermott, directed by Ray Tipton. The associate director, Kathy Hunt, broadcast associates, Brian Rome and Dave Forrest. The technical manager, Matt Benedict, audio engineer, Billy Schnack. The lead tape is Tom Hayes. The coordinating producer of the studio show, Scott Ackerson, produced by Gary Lang, directed by Bob Levy. The senior producer of Fox Sports is Bill Brown. The executive producers of Fox Sports, Ed Gorin and David Hill. They're bragging about missing school here in Seattle to get a whiff of this. Now that's doing the Rex Hudler up there.
Oh, I don't have those kind of skills. I might have when I was his age.
We will get you away from that guy and look ahead to game three of this series. We know there will be a game three. Sealy and Sabathia hook up. That's on Fox Saturday at 4 Eastern, 1 Pacific. We know there will be a game four if the Mariners can close what they need to close here in the top of the ninth.
Well, what Gonzalez will see from Kazuhiro Sasaki is a good fastball, the low 90s, 93 miles an hour. He's got a slider that he uses occasionally, but that split finger is his main pitch. He'll throw that at two different speeds. One speed to his split finger is a just get me over pitch. And then the other one he'll use is his strikeout pitch that ends up in the dirt.
He is called Daimajin, a mythical Japanese superhero type. Just nasty, and it's 0-2.
That was that filthy split finger. Really tied Gonzalez up.
On their feet looking for Sun Shin. Three strikes. Got a piece.
That's pretty much split finger from here on out for Gonzalez. Very tough pitch for a hitter to decide whether it's a good hitting pitch or one that's going to end up being a ball out of the zone. Kazuhiro, he was rookie of the year last year, but he, like Ichiro, is certainly no rookie. He held the lead, but he was the all-time save leaders in Japan. Knew it was coming. Another tough split finger.
Ellis Burks now with one out. Seattle set this up perfectly today. Moyer for six. Nelson in the seventh. Rhodes in the eighth. Sasaki in the ninth. And two outs away from going back to Cleveland, tied at one game, one game.
Kazuhiro, when he was over in Japan, and I got to play there one year in 1993, and I faced him, and he threw a lot harder then. Of course, he was younger. He threw around 96 miles an hour to go with that split finger. He was almost unhittable. having similar success here in the States.
He is facing the man who has been the most successful hitter in this series so far for Cleveland, Ellis Burks. 4-for-7.
Has a hero pitch for the Yokohama Bay Stars. This game pretty much has unfolded just like Lou Piniella has wanted. He wanted the lead after six so he could bring in his very talented bullpen. They've all got the job done.
Moyer, the three-hit shutout through six. He carried the load today. Now it goes to 3-0 to Burks. Chuck Finley, meantime, finally getting that postseason start that he's been aching for. Well, he gave up four runs before he got a single out. There's the strike, 3-1.
Cleveland needing base runners, and Burks knows that. He's going to take a strike. He might even take one more.
One pitch. McLemore couldn't get it. Base hit for Burks again. Five hits in a two-game series, and now Tomey to the plate.
Burks got a pitch he liked out over the middle, 3-1. He worked himself into a good hitting count, and that's what you get when you're patient as a hitter. Good pitch to hit.
Jim Tomey, who finally was able to finagle a single in the seventh inning. He had struck out a couple times Tuesday, a couple times today. Punching it straight up into the air to center. There's Cameron. Beginning to look like the SS Mariner is back in the water.
Mariners had the right guy going in Jamie Moyer, 20-game winner.
You said it right at the top. Their most meaningful game of the season. They played so many meaningless games this season. With 116 wins. And the division wrapped up pretty much by Memorial Day. Oakland made the incredible second half run, but still finished 15 games behind. Kreiman shoots it out of play, 1-1. Talked about Jamie Moyer, did not get to start in the postseason last year, fractured his kneecap, pitching in a simulated game. Got the chance today, but he was terrific.
Looks like he might have rolled a curveball off there. Is rocking. Ooh, nice break to it. Travis Freiman, 2-for-3 off a Sasaki lifetime.
Seattle racing out with that 4-run first. Have traded runs since then. One strike left to get for Sasaki. again, Fryman wouldn't bite. And we go full.
Fryman doing a nice job being patient, looking for something he can handle.
Cordova would be next. Fryman requesting time. There is a record crowd here today. 48,052.
Every one of them standing. Trying to give the Mariners a nice send-off to Cleveland Jacobs Field.
This best of five is now a best of three. Tied at one, back to Cleveland, Fox Sports, home of Major League Baseball playoffs and World Series. Returns after these messages from your local Fox station. Did what they had to. They beat the Indians 5-1 today, and Rex Hutter, Jamie Moyer, was outstanding.
He did everything he wanted to. Kept the Indians off balance with his fastball, changeup, curve, and mainly changeups and out of the strike zone.
138-year-old lefty beats back another. Moyer over Finley. The Mariners over the Indians. Again, the final was 5-1. For more information on today's game and for the latest in Major League Baseball news, log on to FoxSports.com. Coming up next on the Fox Family Channel, East Coast step by step, West Coast you'll see so little time. Coming up tonight on Fox, Game 2 of the Division Series, the A's looking to go up 2-0 on Derek Jeter and the Yankees. The road to the World Series continuing tonight on Fox at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. So for Rex Hutler, Josh Lewin saying so long from Seattle. Again, your final in Game 2, the Mariners 5 and the Indians 1.